replaced by Star Trek sounds. Enjoy. Will be with us, so don't go anywhere.
Like being in your room. I mean, you're alone, and there are a bunch of people wearing green stuff, and it's a big green stage.
Oh, technically, you mean they have to kind of course, the animated stuff is done later, so you're acting to almost, you're acting to no one.
Acting to no one.
Yeah.
The good side doesn't respect you, or they turn on you, and it can really make you bitter, and you say, look, I've been trying to be good all this time, and, you know, why? I'm not getting anything out of it, so let me just flip over and work on the side of evil. It's so easy to be evil.
You underestimate the power of the dark side. If you will not fight, then you will meet your destiny.
When we come back, the magical effort behind making the Star Wars trilogy look and sound better than ever.
A short refresher course for your skin. Start with a cleanser that feels this refreshing.
Eva says you're our only hope.
He's no princess!
Sure he is.
No, I love you! Now what's happening?
Uh-oh.
It's dark steam.
Use the force, he said.
Too late! I'm here! I'm going back to Pizza Hut where it's safe! I don't think the force was with me!
Now you can collect one of 3 Star Wars posters when you buy a Pizza Hut kids pack.
Meet the world's greatest nanny.
I'll do everything from telling stories to changing diapers.
Put me down for one of each.
On a special Simpsons, Friday at 8, 7 Central.
I wanted to see if I was as strong as you.
Spider Man has met his perfect match.
Who are you?
Just a stray.
But is this feline foe or friend?
There's one last thing I have to tell you.
The Secret of the Black Cat. On an all-new Spider Man Saturday after Beetleborgs on Fox Kids.
It's a mystery. Police have no suspect in the murder of a young couple in Chesterfield County. A 24-year-old man and 23-year-old woman found dead inside their home. I'm Diane Walker. We'll have that story tonight at 10.
Hi, I'm Dick Strauss for Dick Strauss Ford. And this is a disgusting, odoriferous tank of piranha. This...
January 1997, the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition premiere. A swarm of stars and fans clamored to experience the film. How is it that 20 years after its initial release, the appeal of this classic adventure is stronger than ever?
I had never been as kinetically thrilled about watching a world that somebody had created that I just wanted to exist in forever. It was really a pretty seminal event, and I think the lives of all of my peers in that entire generation, as a matter of fact.
This movie brought the movies to a different age 20 years ago, and I think it's going to be the same situation here 20 years later, because kids are really going to get to see what a real movie is like.
Exciting. I never thought something like this would happen, but it's been a big thrill.
When Star Wars first came out, it was heralded as a groundbreaking film. But despite its worldwide acclaim and universal appeal, George Lucas felt that the film never lived up to his original vision. The 20th anniversary of Star Wars gave him the chance to make it the way he always wanted.
You don't need to see his identification.
We don't need to see his identification.
Move along.
Move along. Move along.
The Star Wars trilogy has thrilled movie audiences for the last 20 years. But since 1983, these adventures could only be seen on the television screens. That means an entire generation has grown up without experiencing the sights and sounds of these films in the way George Lucas had always intended.
Star Wars was designed to be a theatrical experience. It was designed to be on the big screen. Sound is extremely important, and it's very important to the overall enjoyment of the film that it be big.
Stop that ship! Blast them!
For those who have never seen it on the big screen, they have really missed the point of the movie. They really have missed the excitement that happens when you sit with several hundred other people and the electricity that goes through the audience when you see that movie. One of the things I wanted to do was preserve the film so that it could be a viable piece of entertainment in the 21st century.
What's that flashing?
Films, you know, do deteriorate and they disappear. I think this one had deteriorated a lot more than anybody expected in 20 years. At the same time, I had an ulterior motive that I'd been thinking about for a long time, ever since the films were finished, which is there were various things, especially in the original film, that I wasn't satisfied with. Special effects shots that never really were finished, scenes that I wanted to include that couldn't have been included for some reason, mostly money and time. I looked at the 20th anniversary as a way as, well, if we're going to reissue them, maybe Fox will go along with allowing me to refurbish them also. So they agreed to that, and that's really what started this whole thing.
In 1995, the restoration began with a concerted effort by 20th Century Fox, Lucasfilm, Skywalker Sound, and Industrial Light and Magic. The task was more daunting than anyone expected.
The most obvious thing that's happened is we've gone back to the original negative, cleaned it up considerably, redone a lot of the optical effects, the wipes, the dissolves, and improved the quality of the film, because it was deteriorating.
Holding her is dangerous. Word of this gets out, it could generate sympathy for the rebellion in the Senate.
I have traced the rebel spies to her. Now she is my only link to finding their secret base.
The actual original negative was so far gone that unless we actually did this at this time, we were never going to have the film to be able to release ever again.
Darth Vader isn't black anymore. He starts out coming up to a navy blue and then getting brighter and brighter as the film continues to deteriorate.
There'll be no one to stop us this time.
Yes, sir.
Part of our task was to take this negative and to try and just get the film so they look the way people remember them looking when they first saw them 15, 20 years ago.
So we brought in a team of film restorationists to start a full-scale film restoration. The first step was to take the original negative apart and physically rewash the entire negative. From that point, we realized that the opticals, which we couldn't rewash because the dirt was built into the elements, also had to be recomposited.
Compositing allows separately photographed items to be placed in the same scene. For example, the seeker ball, the lightsaber, and the chess pieces are combined with live action to make up one final shot in the film. Creating composites for the original release of the trilogy required film technicians to physically handle the negative. This led to wear and tear as well as dirt deposits on the final picture. Today, compositing takes place with computers. But before this technology could be applied to Star Wars, all the original elements had to be located. Some scenes had as many as 40 elements for a single shot, as was the case for the asteroid sequence in Empire. Typically, these elements are discarded after the film is completed.
In the case of Star Wars and Empire and Jedi, all those pieces exist. That was due to the fact that George kept everything. So that gives you the ability to do this.
You're not actually going into an asteroid field.
It'd be crazy to follow us, wouldn't it?
Although Star Wars required the most attention, The Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi had their fair share of technical limitations.
One of the biggest sequences we worked on Empire Strikes Back was the snow battle, the walkers and the speeders in the snow. All of that was done at a time that we used optical technology, of course, to do all that compositing. And a telltale sign that something's been optically composited is a black line around it. And when you have a sequence that takes place in outer space against stars, it's easy to reach a point where those black lines don't show up. But when you have a sequence that takes place against snow in the daylight, every hint of that black matte line becomes very visible. And so the first time through doing the snow battle here 17 years ago, a lot of effort went into finding ways to minimize that black line. One of the ways was to not print all of the elements at their full opacity.
All right, coming in.
Consequently, when you see the snow battle on film, you may notice that there's part of the scenery is visible through the cockpit. And it was a constant trade-off of how transparent can we make the cockpit? At what point is the black line more objectionable than the transparency? And so there was an opportunity to go back into those shots, use the computer technology, and to eliminate all the transparency, but also to not have any matte lines.
Another unique aspect of the trilogy is the sound design created in this unknown world.
We would be honored if you would join us.
20 years ago, Ben Burtt set out to capture an organic array of sounds that would soon come to characterize lightsabers and droids. Now he's back, digitally enhancing the sounds that have come to define the world of Star Wars.
This is all your fault.
We didn't want to throw out the sound in the film and do it over. There were so many plastic things in it. So many things that we couldn't do better. And they also represent what the film is and how it's known to people. So that we did our best to bring them to the audience as clearly and as high fidelity as possible now.
The whole company is based on the philosophy that sound is 50% of the experience. And one of the things that I'm most proud of is the work that both Gary and Ben have done in the remastering of the soundtrack, because the original mix was so complex, so good, but there was no technology to actually hear it. And one of the things that George has spent an enormous amount of money trying to develop is a THX system in which allows theaters to present films in the way in which filmmakers actually make them.
THX is, for lack of a better term, it's a philosophy. THX was something that George started back around Return of the Jedi, when he developed a specification that theaters needed to meet. They had to use certain types of speakers and components that would deliver a certain performance to be called a THX theater. And for us, it's a plus, because you work, hours on end and doing these little nuances, and if it goes out into the theater that can't reproduce it, that the audience won't hear those tiny little things we've done.
Another advance in theater technology is the advent of digital sound. All three films in the special edition have been remastered digitally.
The advantage of the sound being presented digitally is that you have five channels of sound. So we redesigned the sound field in the film to bring more of the sound off to go around the audience. So a spaceship can fly from behind you and move all the way to another corner. You also can reproduce low frequencies much more effectively, so you can get a subwoofer, a rumble that's much more effective. Vader uses the Force and there's a rumble, and we've made you hear that rumble now.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
Here they come.
I think we have the music sounding much clearer now with the split surrounds. You can hear the whole orchestra and a lot of the nuances in the music that might have gotten garbled or a little buried in the original versions.
When we come back, a look at the trilogy's special effects and a few new surprises as well.
People drive in Saturn, but I sure know about...
It's a parent's worst fear.
I've got your daughter.
Money tomorrow, 10 a.m. or the girl dies.
Now, Detective Nina Marino will stop at nothing.
I gotta find her. She's my baby.
To get her child back alive.
Where is she?
A brand new New York Undercover, next on Nonstop Fox.
20 years ago, George Lucas' mythical vision of a futuristic past was limited by many challenges, the most daunting of which was technology. All that's changed now.
This is it.
The digital technology frees you up, especially in a fantasy film like this, in ways that are basically overwhelming. You could think of things, and you can write things in science fiction and fantasy, but it's very hard to make that literal.
George had very specific shots that he wanted to be able to achieve, but it was extremely difficult to do that with models on wires. It was impossible then with motion capture to actually get really quick pans. You know, they had to be separate shots. The models couldn't fly directly over the head of the camera without seeing how that it was shaky. And so although for us, when we first saw it, it was still powerful, it was still big, he never got visually the dynamic shots that he actually wanted to get. So we've redone those. Now you can actually see them. They come straight over camera, they go underneath camera, and we can pan with them. That was a real challenge, but a really, really a great deal of fun to do.
Moss Eisley's spaceport. You will never find the more wretched hive of scum and villainy. We must be cautious.
And Moss Eisley was one of the scenes that actually prompted this whole adventure of redoing the movie. I couldn't make it into this bustling spaceport that it was supposed to be. It looked like a little tiny town because I only had like a half a street to shoot on and no real special effects or matte paintings to work with. So I've added a few scenes, and at the same time I've taken a lot of the special effects shots that weren't really as good as I'd hoped they would be because they were sort of prototype technology, and I've been able to improve them and just add that little difference, which is for me what makes the shot special.
There's been some attempts we've been making just to see how far we can push sort of the digital backlot idea, that we can do more and more work with synthetic sets, and we're refining the technology to make, you know, characters and creatures look more realistic than they have before.
The idea of digital backlot is best exemplified by Moss Eisley. Miniatures and blue screen actors are photographed separately, then digitally removed from their surroundings. They are then composited to the photographed miniature. Through computer graphics, elements such as this speeder bike are created and added to the composite, along with other digital elements like Luke's land speeder and the Ronto creature. These Jawas atop the creature put the final touches on the scene.
Things that would occur to George that might make a moment a little different or might open up a sequence a little more, let the audience see something they hadn't seen before, and just in general to kind of add a new twist to a moment or extend a moment a little more. Those shots tended to be the ones that required a new shot from scratch, like the arrival at Moss Eisley and the Falcon's arrival in Cloud City and opening up the singing number in Return of the Jedi.
Return of the Jedi hosts a wide variety of exotic and bizarre creatures from throughout the galaxy. Nowhere is this better seen than in Jabba's palace, with an out-of-this-world band and a singer named Cy Snoodles.
Originally, George envisioned a large musical number at the very beginning in Jabba's palace, but the state-of-the-art animatronics had only reached a certain level. And although there were a lot of characters, none of them really quite moved properly. Cy Snoodles couldn't really open her mouth. She couldn't lip sync properly. Her eyes didn't move. It was a very complex creature to develop. And I think this gave us the opportunity to actually open that up.
There was a stage built over here at ILM where we shot the plate photography for the new footage. And then we eventually put our CG characters into that.
By making them computer graphics, we're able to get them to get up and sing and dance a little more than they were able to first time around.
We've added one new character that they didn't have the time to actually develop on the third film, a Yasm. And he acts as a counterpoint to Cy, and they have a little duet. And it's just a fun musical number.
Another character receiving a digital makeover was mentioned, but mysteriously absent from the first film. Jabba the Hutt made his debut in Return of the Jedi as a massive mechanical slug requiring six operators. Slated to appear in the first film, scenes were shot with a stand-in actor for Jabba. The plan was to replace him in post-production with a stop-motion puppet.
The Jabba the Hutt scene with Han Solo, part of it was that we ran out of time. Part of it was that ILM had so much pressure on them to do so many shots in such a limited amount of time. It became apparent very early on there was no way to put a big stop-motion special effects sequence in the middle of the movie.
It was a scene that didn't need to be in the film if only the first film was going to be completed. And of course, he had no idea that the film would be successful, so that he would be allowed to finish the second and third chapter of the film. So once he was able to do it, then it became an important scene to put back because it was an introduction to Jabba.
Solo!
Right here, Jabba. Been waiting for you.
Have you not?
You didn't think I was going to run, did you?
This is the original play that George shot. So the plan was for us to remove this actor and replace him with Jabba. He had to be physically in that space where this actor was, doing all the same things in a similar kind of style. The ultimate goal is to make it look like Jabba was on the set talking to Harrison Ford, and we just photographed it. This project here was about 5 shots, took about a year to do. We take the picture of some of the stuff we found. We use some of the off-the-shelf software to build a 3-dimensional wireframe mesh. This is kind of equated with taking a canoe without a canvas and building the rungs of the canoe and then wrapping it with canvas. And then the next process is actually paint the creature. And with the painting of the creature, it also involves the actual texture of the surface of the characters.
After the modeling and lighting of the computer-generated character is complete, the task of moving this once immovable slug created a new set of challenges.
The actual motion of Jabba never really existed before. Even in the rubber manifestation in the third one, there was a real sarcasm about him, even though he didn't really move that much. Over time, it became evident that the mass of the character would allow us to make him move like a sea lion. We had to slim it down to convince the audience that it actually had the ability to move. Over a span of how many years, when he makes it to the third one, he gained an enormous amount of weight, you know, from eating some of those greasy little frogs.
We got to a certain point where everything was set, but there was one problem. Han Solo walks around Jabba, and Jabba had not been designed yet. Of course, this stuff was shot 20 years ago, and we were stuck.
Not only did I have to get Jabba close to him, who had a larger mass than this character, we had to somehow shift Han. It would have been literally impossible for him to walk behind the Jabba character because of the tail. So George had the idea, so why don't you have him step on his tail?
Even I get boarded sometimes. You think I had a choice?
It's not just a scene about digitally replacing, you know, a placement actor with a CG character. It's also a scene now that actually shows the dynamics between the two of them and their relationship. And it's a very funny little moment.
Jabba, you're a wonderful human being.
Baska.
What does the future of the Star Wars saga hold? We'll hear from George Lucas when we return.